diagram, right? In any of the textbook, if you take a look, they will basically, when they introduce a feedback control, they will basically give you a graph, or diagram of such a picture that will basically include the very important, your plug, your actuator, because why this actuator basically drive the input to the plug, because the actuator is also taking signal instruction from the controller. Okay, then of course you have a sensor. Sensor basically is a measurement sensor that it measures the output and then it feedback to your controller. So in this case here, if you were to look at a very simple basic controller, it consists of a comparator and also an amplifier. Amplifier primarily, a lot of time the output signal from the sensor is actually very low voltage, so you need to actually amplify it. If you don't amplify it, you cannot use it to drive your actuator. Right? I mean, if you're talking about your motor, plus minus 15 volt, if the signal come out from the sensor is in millivolt, how do you drive the motor? You can never drive the motor. Your motor will hardly move. Okay, so these are the things that, I mean, a very basic thing that, you know, why you need to have the amplifier. Primarily, the signal come out will be very small. And of course, a very important thing will be your reference input. Okay, so our assumption is, if we were to talk about feedback control system, it will look typically of such. It must have a plug. And then sometimes we call it a plant. When you incorporate the plant together with the actuators, we call it a system. So you can actually call it a system also, some in some textbook. So it's like your, like if you read the newspaper, right? They call it the in the Air Asia thing, they talk about this stability communication system. Okay? It's something similar. That is basically what they are talking about, stability augmentation system. Is basically to augment your flight control. The flight control augmentation system, which the pilot actually switch it off. Okay? Deliberately. So that's quite interesting. I mean, when you go into your aerospace control, when you learn a little bit more, then you have a better understanding. Then you understand why, you know, this certain thing. So I mentioned to you guys why Airbus is always very smart. So actually the thing right now is you can actually switch it off. So maybe next time they will switch off the stability augmentation system. Because what happens is the stability augmentation system will inhibit the pilot from flying the plane at high angle attack, flying the plane in a way that you're going to crash the plane. Okay? So when the pilot is smart, switch it off. So it's still the same thing, right? So I mean that is their design. Okay, so that is actually Airbus design. So so I don't know. You know it's good or it's bad, sometimes subjective. If you don't know, then that's it, I just go down to the end. But if you know, then it's a torture, right? Okay, alright, back to our system, this feedback control system. So this is engine governor. So this is a very simple, typical engine governor, like your EMS, engine management system. So you have your plant, in this case here, basically it's your engine, right? Your IC engine or any kind of engine that you have. Then of course you have an actuator. Actuator basically will be your fuel pump. Because what happens here is you are actually pumping fuel into the your internal combustion chamber, right? To burn. And then of course from there you produce the torque required to drive the vehicle. So in this case here is basically, you can think of it, this is a drive shaft, right? Omega in this case here is angular velocity, is basically driving the vehicle to move forward. So the more fuel is actually being pumped into the engine, of course you expect the vehicle to respond much faster, right? I mean, because you expect the output omega to be higher, and as a result, that you can actually move faster. Then of course, at the feedback side, you have what we call a tachometer. Tachometer basically is a sensor, it's a direct measurement of velocity. Okay, so you if you look at this, if you think about what we are saying, earlier on, we will look at velocity feedback. So this is a case of what we call a velocity feedback. Because what happened here is your tachometer is a direct measurement of velocity. So you have a velocity output here. You can actually measure it and you feed it back into your EMS, your engine management system. So your engine governor. So of course, in this case here, you have a reference. So all this omega reference is actually pre-calibrated. So what you see as a driver, you don't see, you see a little bit of the RPM and all this and that, but primarily when you drive, you're not going to be looking at the RPM, you're looking at the switching gears and so on. But typically, these are all pre-calibrated. So maybe at the outer loop, you have another loop basically to make sense and to relate to your speedometer and so on. So this is now what we are saying And that is basically the error that we are looking at. We want to minimize this error. Okay? And that is one of the problems that we say is a tracking controller, and it actually works for a lot of the servo mechanism flaw, okay, or flaw problem. So your servo mechanism system primarily involving motor, right, as an actuators and so on. So your motor will be one of such. And then of course, in your flight control, you also have your servo mechanism. It depends because flight control primarily sometimes they still use, they don't use a servo, they use hydraulic, because hydraulic is a better actuator if you need to move a large, heavy surface and all that, control surfaces and so on. Okay, so important thing to remember, this is a diagram, a typical diagram that we will be talking about, and you will be seeing this diagram for at least for the next 3 lectures, right? I mean, without fail, we'll be looking at this every week. Okay, so now, if I have to zoom in, here, we did mention this is your actuating error signal, ES. This is a reference input, this is your CF. So what happened here is, I'm assuming that HS is equal to 1. As I mentioned to you all before, HS is equal to 1. We are basically saying that HS is only a unit converter. As far as gain is concerned, it's a 1-to-1 gain, but it does actually change a unit. Right. So if you were to say that, okay, if CS and RS is of the same unit, then of course, I mean, it's easier, right? Because if reference input is in velocity, output is also in velocity, and then I can actually assume that the feedback is actually velocity. So at the comparator here, I'm actually comparing the velocity with velocity, I'm actually okay. Alright? But physically, you know that's not the case. Because why? Because you cannot actually compare velocity with velocity. Because even if you're using a tachometer as a feedback, tachometer, the output from tachometer is not going to be velocity. I mean, what you see is the velocity. Coming out is actually in terms of voltage and so on. Okay, so primarily there is a conversion. So whatever you have here is actually a conversion for whatever value you want for your velocity converted into equivalent voltage. And as a result here, at this point, you can actually compare. Okay, but in a way, sometimes when we look at the control problem, I mean, if we do not want to complicate ourselves, and if this is a reference input, is velocity, output is velocity, and then there's a unity feedback, though you have a sensor, you assume that the sensor can actually measure it, then we will just leave it as it is. Okay, so you don't have to think that every time the input has to be in voltage and so on. But typically, this is what's going to happen in reality. In reality. But when you do your problem analysis and so on, it can actually come in as a velocity. It can come in as a position. It can come in as acceleration also. Okay? Alright, so now, what we are interested is, if we were to take a look at this comparator, and based on what we have learned for a comparator ES, ES is going to be equal to what? RS minus CS. Correct? This drop at this summing junction here, ES is going to be equal to RS minus CS because there's a negative sign there. Okay? So as a result, as we put it, assuming HS is equal to 1, so ES is equal to RS minus CS. So if I take this expression, I just divide it throughout by RS. So what do I get? I get ES over RS is going to be equal to 1 minus CS over RS. What is CS over RS? Your closed loop transfer function. Okay, your closed loop transfer function. CS minus RS. I mean, CS divided by RS is your closed loop transfer function. So basically what we are saying is, if I want to understand, okay, if I want to understand how the actuating error relating to your reference input, is basically all I need to do is I need to establish the relationship between my closed loop transfer function. So once I get 1 minus your closed loop transfer function, I can actually try to find out what is my ES over RS, the relationship. I can actually obtain it quite easily. Okay? But one key thing, as we mentioned, if we were talking about tracking controller, tracking problem or servo mechanism problem. If this ES is equal to RS minus CS, what do you want your ES to be? By looking at this one, can you tell me what do you want your ES to be? Zero, right? A lot of you all agree. You want it to be zero. Why you want it? basically, we say follow the input. Okay? When ES is equal to 0, RS is equal to CN. Right? Is it 0? Of course, RS is equal to CN, or CS is equal to RS. So in a way, we say output is following the input, and then basically achieving what we call a tracking controller. Okay, so the key thing, we do know that in your feedback controller design, the whole objective is to drive ES towards 0. Because when ES is actually at 0, we actually have achieved your tracking capability. Output basically following the input. Okay, any questions? So the first thing that we're going to introduce, we talk about that. Now, we're going back to, if you were to look at this, okay, so actuators is actuators, but you do see that a lot of time when we discuss about your basic control action, your basic controller, your sequence controller, we will drop the actuators, right? Primarily actuators because it's quite a simple thing that you model them and all that, so you know, I mean, you don't trouble too much with that. Okay, important thing is basically to look at this amplifier G1N, and that is where we actually replace it. So the first one we're looking at is what we call a proportional control. So what does a proportional control do? Proportional control basically is, because this is your actuating error signal, going through this KP value, so this KP value, what it does is actually amplify your actuating error signal. Okay, so it's in a way, because KP is a constant, so if KP is 2, so if your actuating error signal is 0.5 times 2, if actuating error signal ES is 0.75, that is 0.75 times 2. So it's always multiplying by this KP value. Okay? And U is basically, your US is a signal to drive your actuator. Okay? It's a signal to drive your actuator. So in a way, you can see that KP is in such a way that this actuating signal is proportional to the error signal. So that is why in the time domain, UT is equal to KP multiplied by ET. KP is actually what we call the proportional gain. Okay, we call it the proportional gain. And in Laplace transform, it's very simple, because if you take this straight Laplace transform, you end up with it, you put it in a way, your G1S is actually equal to your KP. This is a gain. Okay, alright. So this is a very basic proportional control. But what happened in this proportional control? Proportional control only works, right? Your proportional control only works, what happens? When ES is non-zero, am I correct? When ES is non-zero, your proportional control will work, because it's just a straight game. When ES is equal to zero, what happens? When ES is equal to zero, that's it. Coming out here will be zero, because you take zero multiplied by any gain, it's going to be zero, alright? So that is a little bit of a downside. Right, there's a little bit of downside, because what happens is your proportional controller works only when your actuating error signal is actually non-zero. Actuating error signal is zero, then your output UT will be something zero. Okay, so in a way, we will take a look of what will be the repercussion and what will be the problem that associated with that. Okay, so this is basically a derivative action. But however, your derivative action, it doesn't actually operate by itself, right? Derivative action doesn't operate by itself. You know that it can actually be added to control by operating on the rate of change of the error signal. So because if you were to look at it, if you remember, we did mention before, right? I mentioned in the Laplace transform, what is 1 over s? 1 over s is your integrator. What is s? S is your differentiator. So in this case here, you can actually see that KES. S basically, in a way, is your differentiator. Except that you do know the Tripoli guys, so you can teach your AE student, the mechanical guy. Differentiation is actually a very noisy process. So the moment you try to differentiate, you actually introduce a lot of noise, and it's something that you do not want. Okay, but it does have some usefulness in this case here. Okay, and we will see one of the usefulness for your differentiations and so on. But typically, you don't use it on its own. So you always couple it together with your P controller. Okay, so when you look at it here, you got a KPET plus a KPTD, DET. So primarily, as we put it, your derivative control works on the rate of change of your error signal. Right? digital, you don't have to split the two together, right? KDGD, basically now they call it KI. So this can actually be replaced with just one term, KI. So it's the same thing. But here, what happened here is a bit, sorry, not KI, KD. What am I thinking, right? KBTD, so it's actually KD. That's what it's actually quoted here. Yes. Okay, primarily this KBTD, as what I mentioned, is equal to KD. But in the past, when you use an analog, okay, because this PID is actually very useful in the process industry, right? Or in KS process industry. So process industry use a lot of this PID controller, and primarily analog controller. So in the analog controller, they actually break the three terms together. They break it up. So what happened here is they have this value. This value is not KP. In the three-term controller, they call it PD, proportionate band. A proportionate band is related to your KP value. And then you take the proportional band together with your derivative time, you actually work out what is your KD value. Okay? Your question is how do you actually get this? Primarily because it's a differentiation. So this is your ES. So EF, you multiply to S is actually the derivative. Right? S in your Laplace transform is derivative. So if you go back to time domain, it becomes dE dt. But what we are saying here is if you look at this here, this actually is a KD value. But in the old way, when you are using analog controller, this is actually KBTD. So what happened is in the past, when people use a PID controller, they adjust what they call the PD, proportional band. And then proportional band, together with your derivative time, you actually combine to get your KD. And then together with the reset rate and so on, you get a KI value. That's your item. But in the modern day, PID controller electronically controlled, electronically designed. So basically, it's just a pure PID. So you just play around with the game. Okay, when you go to MATLAB, you can actually see that, you can actually play around with the PID. It's just a number that you key in, and then you just run an arrow. But in the past, when all this actual physical PID controller is actually designed, it's primarily analog. Okay, analog. So it's analog in the sense that you actually use it to control the bar. So in the process, as I mentioned, in the process industry, all this we use it to control the bar to allow the flow into the tank system, because it's very commonly used in the oil and gas process industry. Okay? So in this derivative time is your TD, and if you were to, all you need to remember is you can actually just put it as KD plus KDS. Okay, so that will be the safest. But I'm also introducing you to this is because later on I'll show you one of the tuning methods that they actually use. Okay, so remember it's KP plus KDS. So if you go to MATLAB, you also put it in as KP plus KDS, and you just basically play around with the KP value. Okay, so derivative action is effective when your actuating error signal is actually changing. Am I correct? So if your actuating error signal is actually changing, so what happened is this is only good during what? During your transient response. Because the moment when you approach your steady state, if you still remember, I showed you the steady state response. What happened to your steady state? Steady state, the response basically is flat out, right? It's actually constant value. If the steady state value is actually constant, what will be the error? If you think about it, if my input RS is a step, unit step, amplitude 1, my steady state value is 0.8. So what is ES? ES is 0.2. Okay, at steady state, because the ES, it doesn't change. The CS is already constant at 0.8. So ES is always 0.2. ES doesn't change. When ES doesn't change, what happens to your DE dt? DE dt equal to 0. ET is actually a constant. So the EDT is a constant. So what happens to your derivative action? No action. Okay, no action. Because why? Because this derivative action only effective when your error signal actually changes rapidly in time. So this is a case where the first one we have seen, actuating error signal is equal to 0, no action out from the controller. Second one, when we talk about your PD controller, your derivative action basically the integral control. Integral control applied to the actuating error signal, UT is varied at the rate proportional to the error signal. So in a way, what happened here is the reverse, right? Your du dt is equal to kiet, or in a way, UT is the integral of your edt. You are integrating. Okay, so in the past, I think you know also, you have this basically reset problem with your integrator. So when you work with anything that is actually using an analog integrator, or you don't have an anti-wind-up actually built in, so what we need to do is we need to reset, right? Because or else what happens, you run into what we call a saturation problem. So what is a saturation problem? So if you're using a PID controller to control your control bar, like you're controlling your engine, so what happens is when you have a saturation problem, that means your valve is permanently open or permanently closed. It cannot actually move on your loop, right? Primarily based on the signal coming in, your PID controller controlling your valve. So your valve should be actually opening and closed to allow fluid flow into your process, right? Your column, your distillation column, and so on. But what happens is when you hit the saturation, so what happens is the valve actually either permanently open or permanently closed. So it's actually no good. So it's a problem that, so that is why we need to do a reset. But now, of course, with the modern electronic PID, basically all come with what we call anti-wind-up. So once you get an anti-wind-up, then you don't have such an issue. So you can actually use it quite rapidly, right? Compared to the older day, where things were done basically using analog circuits and so on. Okay? So in this case here, Ki is actually known as an integral gain. But if you were to look at it, what happened here is your integral action is sometimes what we call the reset control. So in a way, you have a Ti also. I mean, here I didn't actually put it in, but never mind, we just take it as the tip. So it's actually your Kp multiplied by your reset rate, divided by your reset rate Ti. Okay? So you can see that in this Pi controller, so here, integral control, you can actually use it on your own. Okay, you can use it on your own, you can also use it combined. So when you combine is how we actually put it as your Ki is actually Kp divided by Tr. Okay, so you can actually see that the whole idea of using your I control action is to reduce your actuating error signal. Okay? The important thing here is PI control is the most widely used control strategy, right? The whole idea in this is because in your P controller, we did mention, P controller has an inherent problem. When your actuating error signal is equal to zero, there's nothing coming out for your UF. So if you were to use your integral control, because your integral control is an integrated effect, because if you remember, right, what is a P controller? P controller is Kp multiplied by your Et. Et equal to zero, coming out from your Pt, Ut is equal to zero. But this one, in a way, if you were to take a look, what is a Ut? Ut is the integration from time equal to zero until the current time. So what happened is, even when Et is actually equal to zero, your Ut needs not be zero. Okay? Ut needs not be zero, even when Et is equal to zero. Okay, so that is the advantage of using your integral action, because what happened here is your integral action, you use it primarily, we use it very widely to eliminate your error, your actuating error signal. Because why? Even your actuating error signal is already equal to zero, you will still be able to provide that control action to make sure that the actuating error signal maintains at zero. Can you follow? If we were to use a P controller, Et is equal to zero, Ut will be zero. Ut equal to zero, what will happen? You have nothing driving your plug. Your plug may be deviated from, your Ct will actually deviate, right? Because there's nothing driving the plug. So now you fit it back, Rt minus your Ct, it becomes a non-zero. Because why? Because initially Et is equal to zero, Ct come out is non-zero already. So when the loop come back, Et become non-zero again. Then it works. So what happened is you're not going to be able to achieve if you were to use your I controller. When you use the I controller, because it's an integration. So even when Et is equal to zero, Ut is not equal to zero. trading error signal is zero, you still have a control action. Of course, one thing is, the moment you use your PF, you use your eye controller, you do recognize what happened here is you are placing what? You are placing a pole, right? Because the integrator is 1/S. 1/S is basically a pole at the origin. So you're placing a pole at the origin into the pole loop. Okay, so directly you are increasing the system order. So originally if your system is basically a second order, using the eye controller, your system becomes the third order. When you close the loop, your characteristic equation is a degree 3 polynomial, no longer a degree 2 polynomial. So when it is a degree 3 polynomial, you need to basically use your root curvature to analyze your stability. Alright, the basic second order quadratic equation and all that, a bit difficult to use. So you need to actually use your root curvature to analyze your stability, and all those who basically come in can be how to analyze your stability and so on. Okay, alright, so that will be your eye control, and then we said your eye control can also be used together with your P curve, so you end up with what we call a PI, a controller. And PI controller is the most widely used control strategy primarily because it actually incorporates the best of both worlds between the P and the I. I can eliminate steady state error, P can actually try to speed up the response and also try to reduce the steady state error. Later on, we will take a look. Okay? So in this case here, you have your KP divided by TI, basically will give you your KI value. Okay? Alright? Okay, the last one is what we call the PID. Okay, this PID is proportional plus integral plus derivative control. So in short, we call it a PID. Benefit of all three control actions can actually be obtained by simple addition. Okay? So in the time domain, we have, if you put it into the time domain, this is how it looks like. In the Laplace transform equivalent, this is how it looks like. And this is interesting in the sense that if you were to analyze closely, what happened here is in your PID controller, again, similar to what we have discussed, you introduce a pole at the origin in a forward loop. So as a result, in a closed loop, you increase the system order, but at the same time, you also introduce 2-0. Okay, you see that at the numerator is S squared plus KD divided by KDS plus KI divided by KD. So you actually introduce 2-0. So of course, we will take a look later on. What is the effect of 0 when you have a system that is actually higher than second order? If you have a system that is second order, you have a system higher than second order, third order, fourth order, how the zero is actually come into effect and so on. Okay, so that we will discuss. Okay, at this point, I just show you, okay, this one I just pull it from the textbook from Ogata. So this is actually, if you want to copy, it's okay, but it's for your information. Alright, I thought it's actually good because I'm not too sure, you know, whether this was actually mentioned. Okay, so this is something that you will see. You basically you are asked, so how do you tune your PID? Okay, how do you actually tune the PID? Okay, you have this PID controller, but how do you actually tune it? This one you can actually get it from the textbook, or you can actually Google it. But different textbooks will tell you slightly different than all that. This one I actually took it just from Ogata. Okay, alright. So, in the old days, they asked specific methods. Okay, so these two gentlemen, Zickel and Winkel, actually they came out with this method. So they actually have two methods. First method is basically what we call open loop tuning. Then the second method is basically is what we call the closed loop tuning. Okay? But in the modern day, so now if you're given a PID controller, how do you tune your PID controller? How many of you all learn to tune a PID controller in a poly state? You use it, right? You learn it before. Okay? How do you actually tune it? There are three notes. knobs for you. It's KPKIKD. How do you actually tune it? Do you learn it in your holiday? Okay. I mean, primarily, modern day PID controller, you tune it very simple in the sense that you tune one at a time. You cannot tune all three. There's no way you can actually tune. So if you have a manipulator, you're trying to tune the path and all that for the manipulator. So typically what you will do is you tune one at one go. And then you keep the other two constant. So you started out with 0-0 for your KI and your KD. Right? You play around with your KP. So typically what we mentioned, your KP, what your KP is going to be doing is it's going to speed up the response. If there's any error in your steady state, right, if there's any error, deficiency between input and output, it will actually get minimized. So you will basically be able to tune that. But you will not be able to tune it too much in the sense that what happened is because if you were to increase the gain too much, it's actually no good, right? Because what happened is your KP is basically is like your op-end gain. So your op-end gain is also a limit. You cannot say that I put in an infinite gain. There's no way you can actually say I put in an infinite gain. Okay? Impossible. So there is a gain. So typically you use your KP term, you tune up your KI and KD. So KP, you increase it, you reduce your error to the point that you are happy. So the second thing that you're going to do is you keep your KP and your KD constant. You use your KI, you adjust the KI value. And typically you can see that by using your KI, straight away you can actually eliminate your error between your input and your output. Okay? But at the same time, you do realize that by doing that, you will see that your response becomes oscillatory. And that's what you do not want. And that's how the third one will come in. Because once you achieve the first two, the third one basically will come in to add that thing. So because what happened is we mentioned, right, your D term basically works during the transient. But D term also has what we call anticipatory effect because it works on the rate of change of your actuating error signal. So it actually corrects, it anticipates the change of the error and it will try to correct it. So as a result, by the time you keep your KP and your KI constant, you can actually use your KD term to bring down your oscillatory response. And that's how actually the modern days, how we do it. Okay. In the olden days, they have this method in a way that I think is used in the industry. So this is a method that you basically, you have a plant, you put in a step input, and then you look at the output response. The output response must look something like this. Okay, the output response that you have, so your plant must be something like a first order type of plant or second order type of plant, okay, with a little bit of delay. So once you work it out, if there is a first order type of plant, you from this response, so what happens is you work out some of this parameter, right? You have a D. So you find the intersecting point, and then to the point you intersect your time axis, you have your time constant, and then you also have a delay time. You measure for this short distance, and then this will be your K value, right? But you don't really make use of the K value. And once you have done this, you can see that, as I mentioned to you, you're basically looking at KP, TI, and your TD. Okay, so in actual fact, they are all coupled together. So all you do is you set your TI, TD value. So what happens is your KP will be T divided by L. So if you're using a P controller, your analog P controller, you use T divided by L, and then if you're using a PI controller, your P term, your KP is 0.9 times T divided by L. So that's the setting that you set, okay? And then your TI and your TD, basically, they are also related to your KI and your KD term. Okay, so this actually you don't need. You go and look at different textbooks will basically give you. So the other method is what we call the second method. The second method is very closely used. Okay, one of the classic examples of this second method is Chernobyl, right? The nuclear reactor, the meltdown. Primarily is this method. You're doing the tuning phase of this method. Okay, in a way that you're doing some experiment. So what happened in this case here is you actually run the plant in the closed loop. So you have this KP, proportional gain. So you increase the proportional gain. So it
method, do we want it to be oscillating?
Yes, you want, so you increase the gain slowly until the point is basically oscillatory. You find from the textbook. Okay, you can get it from the textbook, any textbook you can find. So this one is nothing, but the only thing is sometimes the value does deviate a little bit, right? Different textbook, okay. Because we need to come back to this, okay? So that tuning and all that is a little bit of a deviation. Just to let you know how this can actually be done, okay? Alright, so one way you can actually play around with this. Okay, now this is what the gist that we need to cover, effect of control action, right? Because we roughly know your PID, we roughly know how it's going to work for us. And now what we need to do is we need to take a look how to actually use the analysis tools that we have actually built up so far to analyze the effect of your control action. So this is typical, as what we mentioned, simplified typical feedback control system where your feedback is actually unity. So you have your plant G2. So G2 now is only incorporated, so you can actually imagine that your actuator is already inside. But basically this is your US here. So US is actually come out from your controller, G1F. G2S is a plant, actually the error signal is ES going into the controller, reference input is RS, output is actually CS. Okay? Alright. So these are all in your plant's transform domain. Okay. So now you can actually work out two things, right? Transfer function. We are very familiar, CS over RS, closed loop transfer function. So what is a closed loop transfer function? You have two blocks in a forward loop. So it will be forward loop divided by 1 plus open loop, because it's a unity feedback, so open loop and forward loop is the same. So it's going to be G1S, G2S divided by 1 plus G1S, G2S. Alright, so this will be your CS over your RS, closed loop transfer function. Then the other one we discussed before, we were interested in one, actuating error signal to your reference input, ES over your RS. Right? Here on this one we were looking at it. So ES over RS, what is ES over RS? ES over RS is equal to 1 minus CS over RS, 1 minus closed loop transfer function. So in a way, you can actually see that while ES over RS is going to be equal to 1 divided by 1 plus G1S, G2S. Okay? Alright? Too far? Okay, follow. CS over RS, would you get this? Winning. Your CS RS is what? Your CS over RS is GS, G1N, G2N divided by 1 plus G1N, G2N. Your friend get a little bit impatient. Alright. Cool, is it? This is what? This is 24 degrees, plus 4 is 16, you know? So you're still 8 degrees off. So you're going to have to consistently ask him to lower the temperature. So to change. You see your friend in shorts and he's still enjoying himself. So
it's not human.
You're very weak. You all have soccer games, you know? Last year, what happened was the students actually played soccer with the Marco and all that. Okay, back to lecture proper. Okay, this is, I will re-upload this slide. plus complex variable S, and then you take the limit of S approaching 0, and you can actually work out what will be the equivalent value. So this is actually exact equivalent. So if your CT is equal to 0.5, if you take limit of S approaching 0, complex frequency variable S multiplied by CS, it should be 0.5 also. It should not be something that you need to convert and all this and that. No. It will be a direct equivalent. Okay? So that is your final value theorem. The only thing that I need to highlight to you is your final value theorem in a way is applicable, but there is a limit. Okay? There is a limit in the sense that it only applies when your limit actually exists. That means your C infinity actually exists. Okay? Because why? Because if you have a ramp function, if your output is a ramp function, Ct is equal to t. And then can you find limit of Ct when t approaches infinity? You cannot, because it's infinity. Right? So you don't have a definite value. Then as a result, you will not be able to use your final value theorem to say that, okay, I use a CS equivalent and all this and then I go through it. You might get some number, but that number has no meaning. So you have to be very clear about your final value theorem when you apply it. You must know that, yes, I have a CT when T approaches infinity. If I do not have that, please do not use it. Because you can get number, but the number has no meaning at all. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay? So important thing is apply only if the limit actually exists. And of course, one of the key considerations is all poles of fs, this function fs, must lie in the left half s plane. So if I take a look on this fs, how many poles you have, they all must be in the left half s plane. At most, you only allow one on the imaginary axis. So in this case here, when we say that everything has to be in the left half s plane, only exception is one pole on the imaginary axis. Where must the pole be? Where must the pole be? Question. Okay, based on the second statement here, all the poles primarily has to be in the open left half plane. If I allow one pole, right, at most I allow, it will be one pole on the imaginary axis. So the question here is, can you comment or can you tell me where that one pole must be? If that one pole has to be on the imaginary axis. You cannot find initial value problem. Okay, so you have a final value problem theorem, you also have an initial value theorem. So what is the initial value theorem? Initial so you got an ending, you got a beginning, right? Alpha, omega, that's what you learn. You heard about that also. So if that one is an omega, then this one is an alpha, right? Because there's a beginning. So you know the ending. So you also want to know sometimes what is the beginning when time is zero positive. When I apply an input at the very instant, what is the output response? So that is basically you trying to find out your function of time at zero positive when you are responding to the input. Okay, when you are responding to the input. So the equivalent of such is basically the same thing. You take a limit, except that now you let s approaching infinity. So you can imagine that when s approaching zero, you're looking at a final value. When s approaching infinity, you're actually looking at a starting value. Okay. In this case here, there isn't any restriction on co-location. You can actually use it for sinusoidal functions and so on. Because you do understand that when you have a sinusoidal function, there are no steady state value, right? When t approaches infinity, you cannot actually quantify what is your value. Right? If you have a sine omega t approaches infinity, what is the value? You don't have. You don't know. Okay? Or at least I do not know. Maybe you have the answer. Right? Okay? Good. You don't know, don't know. Okay, so you can see that value of f function of f at time t zero positive can actually be obtained from the Laplace transform of ft. So what we are saying here in this cool theorem, what you learn in your AM2S primarily, it actually is very good because as a setup, we already transformed ourselves into the Laplace transform. We need not go back. If you imagine that, if you're looking at RS, you're looking at CS, then suddenly they ask you, okay, hey, what is the CT when T approaches infinity? Then you're going to have to do an inverse Laplace transform, you know, that sometimes is rather complex. So if you know your final value theorem, straight away, you can actually apply it, and without actually come back and check to see what is your CT, and then you let T approaches infinity. So that is actually is usefulness. Right? You do not need to transform between the time domain and your frequency domain. And of course, the other thing is actually the theorems actually provide a convenient check on your answer. Right? When you look out an answer, at least you know you can actually cross-check. Okay, alright. So the thing here I want to also mention, I think this one is not your notes, but I think this actually is a very useful thing.
It's like for this slide.
This slide is in about it. The section 5, 6, 7, 8, is it mentioned? It's not mentioned, it's not covered. It's not covered. But, so this one I teach extra from because the last school people they only see the section 5, 6, 7, 8. So this one is something that I think is actually very useful. But you must understand, if you want to use it, you must understand. Once you understand, you can see that a lot of things can be shortcut. Okay, so what I'm teaching you is you need to understand the fundamental. Once you understand the fundamental, all this basically can be used as a shortcut. Okay, shortcut meaning you don't have to go through all the procedures. Okay, I teach you the final value theorem. Once you learn it, you don't need the final value theorem. Okay, to be honest, you don't need the final value theorem. More or less, if you're working with things that is in that fashion, in that manner, you can actually apply this and then you can write down the answer. And that is not wrong. Okay, you're not going to be marked wrong. Okay, so this is basically, this is actually from Franklin and Powell. Okay, Franklin and Powell actually mentioned, but other texts I'm not too sure whether they mentioned, your DC gain. Triple E before you know what is a DC gain, right? But in control, how do we actually use this DC gain? In actual fact, it's actually is set as a ratio of the output of the system to its input. And presumably, this input is a constant input. So the only thing that you use the DC gain concept in your feedback control is when your input is a step input. Right? Because a step input, then your input is actually a constant. RS is actually 1 over S. 1 over S is a constant value. So if you have a unit step input, because what? This is your output, steady state output. You are taking the steady state output, because here we are talking about all transients have decay. So you are looking at steady state output to the ratio of the input, which presumably is constant, is basically 1 over s. Okay, because why? Because what happened here is, if you were to look at this, right, what is your GS? GS is your transfer function. GS multiplied by 1 over s. 1 over s is your input. So GS multiplied by 1 over s is actually your output. Alright, it's your output. And based on this expression here, this is your steady state output value. Alright? It's your steady state output value. And when we say your DC gain, DC gain is your steady state output value over your input. Preferably, your input is a unit step input. That's what we put it here, presumed constant. So basically, in a very simple way, you're taking the steady state output value due to a unit step input. So if you divide it by 1, you don't divide it by 1, you're going to get the same thing, alright? Because your input is a unit step. If input is a unit step, input amplitude is equal to 1. So you take the output value divided by 1, so it's the same. Can you all follow?
So we repeat one more time.
Okay. If I have to write it in, right? So what happened exactly, your DC gain? Okay, we are basically saying that this is basically limit of T approaches infinity, your CT. Input basically is 1. Because your RT is actually equal to 1. Input is a unit step. So your DC gain is actually, what you do is you take your output value, steady state output value, and then you divide it by your input. Your input in this case here is a unit step. Alright? So this is your output, right? CT of T approaches infinity. That's basically your output. Steady state output value. Where all the transients have actually decayed. All the transients have decayed. So this is your steady state. So this is your steady state output. Okay, so this is actually your unit step. So this is a unit step constant input. Alright? So that is a DC gain. Yes, because your input you already assume to be a unit step. Okay, the input you already assume to be a unit step. Alright, so this is what you do in your DC gain. Okay, so DC gain, in a way, you put it, is actually what we call a system gain. A system gain. Okay, alright, agree with this? Okay, now the rest of your guys. In Jared here, Jared Fang. Anyone who is friend? He has no friend. You are his friend. Because he, I saw his attendant, they have not signed in for the last few times. So I was just wondering, where is he? Let him know. He's busy with something. We call it the system gain. simple term, you can even simplify it by looking at this. All I need to do is I look at all the constant terms. So to me, what is the DC gain for this system GF? 3 times 2 divided by 10 is 0.6. Okay? Based on the definition, DC gain is going to be equal to GF when you set all S equal to 0. So in the very simple term, even more simplified, all you need to do is you look at this, you look at this, you look at this. This is the DC gain, 0.6. So what we are saying here is, if your input is 5 UT, a unit step with amplitude 5, 5 times 0.6, what is the steady state output value? 3. So your CSS infinity is 5 times 0.6 is equal to 3. Okay? Alright? Okay with this? Is also relating to your whole location of your first order system that we discussed before. Alright? Because if you remember, we were talking about first order system, then we have this, and then we say, okay, you have a pole on the wheel axis. Right? Because it's a first order system, so only pole on the wheel axis. It cannot be in a complex plane, because complex plane, you must be at least second order to go into a complex plane. First order, you can only be on the wheel axis, and then we say, okay, ask you all, and all you all got it correct, right? We're saying that if you have a system, you have a very long time constant where the pole must be located, and then all of you all say, hey, closer to the K omega axis, and that was correct. Okay, so you can actually see that based on this expression here. Okay, what is your pole location for this? You remember, right? Pole location, you take this, you set it equal to zero. So the pole is actually S is equal to minus 1 divided by tau. So when tau is actually a very large value, what happens? It's actually very small, very close to the J omega axis. And that's what you told me the last time, so I still remember that. So that's good. And then now, we're coming back. What is the definition of a time constant? rise it up to 63.2% of your final value. That's the time constant. Okay, 63.2% of your final value. So cross-check it with the textbook. Make sure that I didn't make any mistake. Okay, so something I did. Alright, because I didn't see anything mentioned. Okay, alright. So in this case here is an indication to show you what will happen when your time constant. So when you have a time constant of 0.5 second versus 1 second versus 1.5 second, what can we actually deduce from here? You can actually see that if your time constant is actually very small, 0.5 second, the response is very far, right? Because this is what is actually coming up. So what we call is we say the speed of the response is very fast. When the time constant is very long, 1.5 second, you can actually see that the response is actually much slower. And that was why I mentioned to you all, right, the example that I quoted for first order system. In your thermometer, it actually is a first order system. If you have a time constant of 1 minute, it will take you a rather long time to take your body temperature. So it is actually no good, right? And in the olden days, you got no choice, right? When I was a kid, you're using those mercury kind of thermometer and then put it into your mouth. It takes the oral thermometer typically maybe half a minute, the time constant. So it takes a rather long time. Now you use a thermal scan, so 2 seconds, 3 seconds, you get the temperature. So that is the difference. The time constant basically gives you an indication how fast your system is going to be responding to the changes. And in this case here, one thing is, when you talk about first order system, you basically also have what we call the time constant relating to your final value, right? Inside your notes, maybe it's actually mentioned here. I don't think I see any of such information. Okay, but typically you remember, if you are 3 time constant, how close are you to your final value? Right? 3 time constant, you are about 5% of your final value. 4 time constant, you are about 2% of your final value. So say for example, my input is a unit step. My output eventually will go to 1. Right, because it's a unit step. So at 3 time constant, I should be at 0.95 of the value. 3 time constant. So if time constant is 1 second, 3 time constant is 3 seconds. At 3 seconds, I should be at 0.95. 4 time constant, I should be at 0.98, 2% of your final value. Okay. And typically, steady state approximation 0.99 is about 5 times constant. So that is the rule of thumb numbers that we are working with. So I will be basically using that. I'll be talking about 3 time constant, 4 time constant, 5 time constant. So 5 time constant typically is what we call steady state. Right? If you want to approximate. So that is why if you were to tell me that this is the time constant of my system, I can basically tell you that if your thermometer is half a minute, then you know that 4 time constant. So it's about 2 minutes. You should be somewhere around 98% of your temperature. So 5 time constant is 2.5 minutes, you should be at your steady state value. So a normal thermometer, 5 time constant, so it should get you very close to what your actual body temperature is supposed to be. Okay? Alright, so these are some of the information, right? So as we put it, your 5% sampling time, what we call the sampling time, is 3 time constant. 2% sampling time is 4 time constant. Steady state time is basically 5 time constant. Okay? Alright. Okay, very quickly, let's take a look at your second order system. For second order system, it's actually represented as such. So this actually is a very simplest transfer function for second order system. We have seen the second order system. So in your circuit, it will be your RLC circuit, right? Your resistance, inductance, and your capacitance, RLC circuit. If you have your RLC circuit, you build it up, you basically you end it up, you can actually use it to model the second order system. The other thing in mechanical system is your spring mass damper. If you put your spring mass and your damper connected to a mass, and then you have a applied force, you basically can actually set up a transfer function of such. Okay? So in a way, if you were to look at this transfer function, you have 2 things. So in your first order system that we talk about, what will be the controlling factor in your first order system? Time constant, right? Because 1 divided by tau s plus 1. So when we talk about your first order system, the first thing that comes response depends on the damping ratio of the system, but we also have zero steady state error based on this. Okay, so this is basically very deliberately put it. Why this one will have zero steady state value? Can anyone else point it out to the class? Why you have a zero steady state value? That's what is being put in here. Based on the tensor function. From what we have learned just now. Thank you. Why this will have a zero steady state value? Basically, your explanation based on this block diagram. Here you got an RS, you got a CS, and you have this tensor function. And typically, what happened here is, as we mentioned, your damping ratio and your undamped natural frequency, it basically control how your response is going to look like, right? Because we know that your damping ratio basically control how oscillatory your system is going to be. Okay? So your damping is 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, all the way. When damping is actually very small, response is very oscillatory. Okay, when damping actually starts to increase, you can actually see that at a point of damping is equal to 1.0, you don't see any oscillation at all. If you were to compare the response between 0.1 and 0.2, 0.1, 0.2, you have what we call overshoot. Overshoot, that means you actually exceeded the final value. So 1.0 is the final value. RK is actually 1.0, is also your input value, and eventually your CT also, you want the response to go to 1.0. If you have zero steady state error, that's what we put it. And we do know that for this system, it should go to 1.0, except that it depends on how long it will take to go to 1.0. And of course, with the damping ratio, we are showing here is if the damping ratio is actually very small, response will be oscillatory, and it will take a very long time for it to actually settle down and to approach your 1.0. Okay? So your zeta actually plays a very significant part, and you can also see that when zeta is equal to 1.0, zeta is equal to 2.0, zeta is equal to 3.0, what happened here is, of course, bear in mind that we are keeping the undamped natural frequency constant. In this case here, you are not changing the undamped natural frequency, because if you change your two parameters, you will change both, it's very difficult to analyze. So in a way, you fix one, you change one, then you can actually see that when the damping is equal to 1.0, you have no overshoot, right? This is basically what we call overshoot. You have no overshoot, and the response basically rises up and goes to the value. But when you increase the damping to 2.0 to 3.0, the response becomes very slow. We call it very sluggish, right? Response becomes very sluggish because why? Because it takes a long time for the response to rise it up. Because we say that typically these are mechanical related systems. So mechanical related system, it cannot respond to the input instantaneously. So as a result, it will always exhibit time lag. So you can see that my input is actually here. But if you were to look at, if you trace the output, output actually exhibits some time lag. Okay? So in this case here, you can actually see that with the damping becoming larger and larger, that is a typical inherent problem that you face in the system. So one of the examples that we mentioned before is your door, right? Your door is actually has a damper. So you can actually adjust the damper. So if you adjust the damper, if the damper is actually, when the damping is actually small, you let go of the door will slam. But if you increase the damping for the damper, for the door, what happens is if you increase it to 2 or 3, what happens? You open, you let go. It takes a long debate it too much, but pointed out to you. So, because why? Because this basically forms the characteristic response of under them. So here, we are talking about under them. Because why? Why I'm not talking about over them and so on. Over them, basically, over them system, if you remember, over them system, you have two railroads on the rail axis. When you have two railroads on the rail axis, it is similar to one railroad on the rail axis, and then you just basically expand it to two, expand it to three. Analysis, very similar to first order. Okay? Here, we are interested in under them, because under them, they actually expand into your complex plane. So when you're in the complex plane, so these are some of the things that are associated with what we are interested in, especially in your design. So in your design, so if you have the time, oh, I've not downloaded the lab and all that, so okay, I'll quickly upload the lab for you to take a look. So some of the things that we need to actually comment on it will be, if you look at a typical second order step response, oscillatory response, a few things you know, overshoot, okay? Definition of overshoot, basically, is given here. And then this value, this tolerance value, is what we talk about, your settling time. So 0.05 is 5% settling time, as we mentioned before, three time constant. Okay, so then you are, hey, just now the time constant and all this and that settling time, we were actually referring to first order system. What about second order system? Do we actually have something that is actually defined for second order system? In actual fact, we do not have. Okay, we don't have a specific definition for second order system, but we do have this definition that we can actually use. It's what we call 1 over your zeta omega n. Okay, 1 over your zeta omega n is what we call the equivalent of time constant to a second order system. Because first order system is very clear cut. What is the time constant? Tau is the time constant. So whatever tau value you have, you know what is the time constant. Coming to the second order system, you have zeta omega, right? Omega n. So what is the time constant, equivalent time constant for second order system? 1 over zeta omega n. So as a result, the settling time here, if you were to use your 5% settling time, as we mentioned, is 3 time constant, so it's 3 divided by zeta omega n. If I talk about 2% settling time, as we mentioned, is 4 time constant, then it will be 4 divided by zeta omega n. Okay, so just bear in mind. So this is what a special case extension that we actually borrow from first order system when we use it for a second order. So some of the things that we also talk about in your second order system design, okay, not so much, but some of these parameters we do use them. It's what we call the rise time. The rise time, it also depends on textbook to textbook order. But of course, the easiest way to do it is basically is to determine the rise time. You set it to from the beginning until the first time the response actually crosses the final value. That is from 0 to 100% of your final value. So in this case here, the 100% of the final value is 1.0. So you take the time taken for the response to rise it up from 0 to 1.0. And that time is what we call the rise time. Because if you take a look at the some of the textbook, basically saying that if I'm using a second order under that system, then I will take 10% to 90%. So 10% to 90% is actually very difficult to work it out. Graphical method, you can actually do it. Calculation-wise, you cannot actually attach an equation for you to calculate it that directly, right? But typically, there will be this equation. This equation primarily good for when you are looking at from 0 to 100% for TR. 10 to 90% cannot, but the equation is not calculable. So you need to actually do it graphically. You have a graph, plot it out, then you take 10% of the final value versus 90% of the final value, and then you actually work it out. Meaning, you actually take 10% and then you plot it out. So this is your T1, then you take 90% somewhere around here, then you chop it up, then you take the 2 times, and then you work it out. That will be your TR, or some of the definition. So if you read different author, different textbook, basically will give different suggestions and so on. Then of course, the peak time primarily is a time associated with the first peak of your response. So if you have an under-dead system, your response, as we mentioned, oscillatory. Response will rise it up, the first time it peaked, that's when you get your TP. So all in all, what happened here is, if you were to look at second order under-dead response, characteristic-wise, have your rise time, you have your peak time, okay? But the important thing will be your setting time, your maximum overshoot, okay? Your maximum overshoot, your setting time will be basically very important. Plus, another term is what we call the error. In this case here, we have zero steady state error. What if you have error, right? Because why? Because we did mention error is an indication of the accuracy of the system. Like you take a lift, you're going up to level 5. When the lift open, if the floor is actually here, then you've got a problem, right? You need to climb up. If the floor is actually too low, then you have to jump off and all that. So that represents some uncertainty and some discrepancy in terms of what we call your performance. Something that you do not want to have. Okay? Alright. So these are some of the terms that you will also see them, but these are not the very important terms. In design, right? If you know the time constant, rise time, peak time, perhaps you can actually sacrifice a little bit sometime. You don't really need to do the calculation. Because what you're more interested in is how long does it take to basically settle down? Alright? How long does it take for it to settle down? So if you're talking about hard disk drive, you have a voice coil, motor, and so on, and the read write head is moving on your medium. Okay? So typically what happens is you know it will oscillate because it's very flexible. But what happens is from track to track, you don't want the settling time to be too long. Right? You don't want the settling time to be too long because why? Because that basically determines what we call your average seat time. Your seat time, you want it to be as short as possible because when you're moving from one track to another track, you want this timing to be short. Because why? That means you are very fast in searching for all your information. Alright? Because if you take a very long time to move around, then again, that is basically governed by your settling time. And that is actually no good. Because it takes a very long time for it to settle down. Right? You can have a very short TR and TP, but if your TS is taking forever, and that is actually not to your advantage as far as performance is concerned. Okay? Alright? So this will be your characteristic of the response of an second order system. But key thing is what we call the performance index. Performance index are things that we actually use to determine how to actually define. So if I have a system that I need to actually design a feedback controller, typically you should be given some of this information, right? Information pertaining to how fast can the output actually follow the input. So as you mentioned, that basically related to your rise time and your peak time, right? How fast can actually try to follow? But at the same time, how long does it take to respond to reach your final value, your settling time? How oscillatory is the response? Basically, is it indicative of the overshoot of the testing and so on? Okay? Because in this equation here, you do realize that if your percentage maximum overshoot, it relates directly to your damping ratio, nothing else. Alright? So that means if I have a damping ratio, straight away I can actually correlate to what kind of maximum overshoot that I can actually anticipate for my system. Okay? So this is the thing that this formula basically relates directly. It's only zeta and MP, MP and zeta. That means you know one, you know the other. If I know my MP, I can calculate my zeta. If I know my zeta, I can calculate my MP, so to speak. Okay? And that is why, in this case here, so a lot of time, in your design requirement, you will be given what we call performance indexes. Right? Your performance indexes will be given to you, how fast I want it to be, how quickly, and then, of course, coupled with this, what is not actually mentioned is your error, right? Your steady state error. Steady state error is also another thing that we will actually mention. So maybe very quickly, this is what to summarize what we have talked about in your feedback control action. Then we talk about your PID, right? Your P, pretty much, we say how much, basically, this the signal is actually proportionate to the size of the error. And of course, we mentioned just now, the bigger the better, right? Because the bigger you can actually reduce your steady state error. So the bigger the error, the greater the control signal is going to be. And then of course, the bigger the gain, you basically will also try to reduce the error. That is the whole objective in your P term. And then the derivative term, as you mentioned, is in a way, is what we call how far. Because what happens is your derivative PID, do your first offer and the second offer system. Generally, derivative basically improve that thing. And your item, as I mentioned, eliminate your steady state error. Okay, so this is used to remove